all-new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Everybody, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. This is show one in our new home, and I'm really excited to have Sonya and Big James Stewart as my first guests on the SML Show. So guys, thank you very much for coming. It's always great to have you guys here in town in Southern California. Certainly miss you guys being part-time neighbors.
I know, right?
Just a couple exits away. Mm-hmm. But man, a lot has changed in the past couple of years. I mean, we just got off a race where Malcolm was the fastest qualifier and won the heat race, had everything going, but he's like one tick away.
Yeah, just trying to, I guess, get his ducks in a row, you know? I mean, it would have been nice to have what I call a three-peat, you know? But that's why they call it racing. Mm-hmm. Never know.
Mm-hmm. Unpredictable.
Very.
Okay, you guys are, you're arguably like the most popular parents in the pits, I would say, at the races, right? You guys probably get called over all the time by fans and everything, but what does it feel like to, I mean, you guys have raised two of the most prolific riders in our sport, in the history of our sport. I mean, is that when you guys started out, when you bombed the first peewees, did you have any of the wildest dreams that'd be like this?
No, I didn't. I mean,
no. I mean, it's just something we did, you know. It was all part of, you know, our race back in the days, and, you know, and she grew up with me going to my races and stuff, and it just kind of all panned out, and we had kids, and obviously, you know, they was going to try to follow dad's footstep, but they took it to a whole different level. Yeah. And it was just more of a family fun deal, you know. Never thought that it would pan out to be at this level.
Mm-hmm. Sonya, what kind of racer was Big James?
he was a good local. Yeah, he was a good local racer. Yeah, he was good. He was good. But if you tell him differently, the boys always look at his photos of him and his riding style and stuff, and they're like, dude, like that, really? And, you know. And he'll be like, yo, man, I can do that. Yeah, look at my style. You know, it's hilarious. It's hilarious. But, you know, that was decades ago.
Yeah. Stuff, so. But how did you get involved in moto?
I always was fascinated with bikes, you know, growing up in the country. And my buddy, he had, you know, at that time we had little Z50s and stuff. So we rode around on the farm with them. And when I moved from Georgia and came to Florida, I got a job at the motorcycle shop as a young kid, wiping, cleaning up and stuff. And the guy that owned the bike shop didn't have any kids. So I was like his kid.
He took you on his wing.
We went somewhere everywhere on bikes and stuff, playing around.
So was it a natural thing for the kids to get involved?
Yeah, because I was still racing, you know, and even when we had little James, I was still doing all the local stuff, and occasionally go out, you know, to Georgia and a couple of tracks like that. But when he got old enough, and plus I was working too, you know, and really didn't have time to train because, you know, had a kid and, you know, responsibility. So I was backing it down for my racing career of it. And really, you know, and he kind of took James, actually took a knack to it. So once he got to that stage, I folded my stuff up and started, you know, pursuing him. Mm-hmm.
When did it become apparent that he was really talented at it? I'm assuming on 50s still, right?
Yeah, but, you know, 50s, he rode good, and he was really good, and a lot of people said it. But to me, when I saw little James, when he really took off, I remember coming to World Mini. I remember putting his bikes in suitcases and flying out here to this race, and putting his bikes together, and we was racing against, I mean, he was young, he was like eight, nine, you know, and actually we was last year 50s, I believe. And, you know, we come out here racing against, you know, at that time, the World Mini Deal, I think the kids race up to, seem like 12 years old on the 50s, you know, they was big, older kids. And we raced the 50 class, and he won the 50 class, and we was in the 60 class, and he was racing against, way older kids than he were, and he was like, he was never intimidated by him. And we wound up second that year. I don't know if the Buckaloo win, one of the older kids that, you know, won the race, but we wind up second. Or Pastrana, might have been Pastrana back then, but I seen the light come on. I saw, you know, like, he was really, really good, but he was little.
Yeah.
He was a little kid back then, and but he just took off.
You know, you see guys' parents get into moto right now, and it's like, I think it's changed and become bigger with the motorhomes and all that and everything, but still getting your kid into a sport like motocross, it's super expensive, right? There's a lot of sacrifices I'm sure you guys had to both make to put the kids on dirt bikes at that level.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely more expensive now, like everything else.
Yeah.
You know? But yeah, a lot.
I mean, was it like, was it a big burden? Like, or did somebody help you out early on? Like, how soon did it happen where people like, hey, special, we're gonna sponsor you?
Dude, my first sponsor was WD-40, and that was, I couldn't wait. Every year we got that case of WD-40. And you know, to me back then, a case of WD-40, you know, it was like, today's time getting a free 450. That's how big that was for me, you know, because, you know, no one gave me anything. I mean, that was, you know, no one gave us nothing. We bought used clothes, used boots, and, you know, we did what we needed to do to go racing, you know, and it was no free handout, you know, it was all, okay, you know, this is what we got to do. And I think, to this day, I think that's what, you know, it helped my kid to, you know, make him realize that you can do it with a little nothing. And, you know, and I can talk about Malcolm, but the biggest thing with little James, I taught him is like, look, the clutch is for start and stopping. That's the only time you get to use this. And he rode his whole career without burning a clutch up, because I told him, I can't afford these clutches. So you're going to have to learn how to ride this motorcycle without the clutch.
Yeah.
He did that until he retired from racing. And I think since you got the four-stroke, when the four-stroke come along, you need to use a little bit more clutching than you did on the 125, but a lot of people don't understand. They think it's the opposite way, but no. The torque spec that this four-stroke have, you can clutch it a little bit and get along.
Yeah.
But two-stroke, you got to wind it all the way up to, you know, to build the power, but you don't have to do it, you know, that way. And I think, you know, if I'm coming back with Malcolm, I think that's why Malcolm is where he's at now. It's because learning how to deal with not having much. You know, learning that, you know, if someone give you something, that's something you got to give back twice. There's nothing free out there other than cheese and a rat trap.
All right. Hey, guys, we're going to take our first commercial break to hear from our sponsors. We're back for more with the Stewarts.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Moday.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Marvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jaden Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
Everybody, welcome back to the SML Show presented by Yamaha Motors and OGIO Powersports. Once again, here with the Stewarts. So, flash forward to today, right now, right? You're in your second go around with son number two. Bubba's World Show. I remember the way it was portrayed was like Malcolm was always off fishing or playing video games and everything. Like, was it really like that where Malc didn't really care about racing as much as James, was a little distracted? And
Yeah, it's actually like that. Well, not, I mean, they took it to a whole nother level, obviously, on that Bubba's World thing. But Malcolm did love fishing. You know, he didn't, you know, he had to figure out, yeah, do I want to race or do I want to fish? Or, you know, it's like, hey, you can't do both, you know, and stuff. So he decided to go ahead and, you know, commit to racing and stuff like that. But yeah, that Bubba's World, you can't believe everything on that thing. Oh, God. At all. That was a nightmare.
So the when did it click for me? Was there ever like where you guys are like, come on, you can.
Yeah, how long? When was it? Like basically, I think it was when he was on 250s maybe.
Where his last year when he went from B and he started getting actually when the light switch come on, I'll never forget, I remember exactly where we were. We was loading cows, because I raised cows. We had a big sale, so we was loading cows. And he would always want to shock them. I said, you don't have to shock them, they're low. But he was just one of those kids that you couldn't really tell them that. But he was always want to shock them. And we was loading, we had some bull who was doing a bunch of bull calf. So he gets them walking down the alley chute, and he gets behind this one bull and he shocks him. And the bull kicks and it just slung crap and it went in his mouth and everything. I say, way to go, son. I say, you got a career right here. And he said, I'm never gonna fool with these cows no more. Oh, and it was like, bam.
Really?
It's like, I don't want to do this. And it was light switch come on and he started,
it was funny.
He started, you know, taking his whole racing series and, you know, went out and he hired this trainer, you know, want to, you know, get himself in better shape. And he just started, you know, clicking it off as we went. And here we are.
Yeah. What is it like watching them both rise to the ranks? I mean, obviously James, you can't compare anyone to James, but Malcolm has enjoyed quite a bit of success himself too, right? So is it satisfying in different ways? Because did Malcolm have to work harder at it?
I think he did. I really do. I think he definitely had to, 100% sure, yeah. And they both are naturally talented. It's just, first, Malcolm just had to work definitely more harder. But I mean, wouldn't you agree?
No, I don't agree. Malcolm has more talent than James. And when I say that, you know, no disrespect to James. James worked, and James never stopped working. And to this day, he still study races. He still study and view it and, you know, overview it. Well, that's what made him who he were, because he would win the race and he would come by and he would dissect it, you know, over and over and find out, you know, what mistake I made, where I was good at. And he would look at his competition and, you know, and study them. Well, Malcolm didn't have to do that because he was just natural. He has natural talent. You know, you have kids that's just born natural with natural talent. Well, that was Malcolm, where he don't feel he need to dissect it. You know, and it was like, but it's not easy for him because, you know, he still have to live up to his brother. But it was just like Malcolm can be out on a couch 2 months, 3 months, and within 15 minutes on a motorcycle, you was like, wow, he's been riding this whole time. And I remember when we was racing for one brand and contract year, and we would go and test another brand, and we would get on the bike. I remember one time, the first time we did it, we went from Suzuki to our first year to the second year to the KTM with Nate as our team manager, and we went out to this, during our outdoor national, we went out to this trike and we rode, and Nate had to pull him in because he was like, dude, we didn't prep this bike to ride that many laps. You know, he was like, we really need to look over. And it's like, he just jumped on it like he's been riding it this whole time. Mm-hmm. And he does every brand of motorcycle that way. And to me, to this day, I feel it hurts him because he learned how to adapt to it. If it's not right, oh well, he adapt mm-hmm. to it instead of, you know, fixing it. And I think, you know, it kind of sets him back because it can be better if he would speak up and have someone, you know, make it better. Mm-hmm.
Can you guys talk about, like, James grew up, obviously, with you saying you can't use that clutch, right? But Malcolm came up, and James had already been successful and everything, and did he have more given to him or less than James?
Well, if you look at the big picture, yes, he had, you know, Malcolm had what they call the golden spoon. You know, he had a golden spoon, but with me, I didn't give it to him. Mm-hmm. I actually hold Malcolm back, you know, because obviously James was, you know, with Kawasaki and was successful with Kawasaki. They gave us everything we needed. Mm-hmm. Well, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't get all the stuff. I wouldn't get him new bikes, you know, because he wasn't proving to me he deserved the new bikes. Mm-hmm. You know, so I would tell Calvin, no, I don't need anything. I'm good. And they would look at me like I was crazy. It's like, no, because he have to earn this. If mm-hmm. you just keep giving and giving and giving, you know, as they grow up, they're going to be expecting it and not know what the real world was. So I actually hold Malcolm bike when it comes to all these gifts and stuff. Mm-hmm.
So the kids obviously have very different personalities, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, as my children do. My younger one's far more loud and aggressive, and my older one's quiet and reserved. Why do you think kids grow up like that, so different from each other? Is it because the younger one has to try to keep up with the older?
Oh, that's a good question. No, Lil James is always, he to me, personally-wise, like, he always been that quiet kid that his goal was race, mm-hmm. race, race. That's it. Malcolm was always that kid that he fished, he played video games, and, I mean, he talked to anybody, you know, any everybody. Like, he was that guy. Even now, same thing. Lil mm-hmm. James, like, he's still on the quiet side, and that's, you know, when you start talking to him and stuff, then you get a little bit out of him, but he still ain't like Malcolm, you know. Malcolm's just Malcolm. And I just, that's just the way them two is. I mean, mm-hmm.
What was it like raising them? Was one of them more trouble?
Oh boy, I don't know. They both were trouble to me, man. I'm gonna say they both were trouble.
Both were
trouble. Yeah, they both were trouble. Yeah, but they were trouble in their own separate ways. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
What's it like being grandparents?
Oh, I love it. I love it. Yeah, I love it. You know, he's the grandpa that loves to see him all the time. Wants him to come over, but he's the first person to go to bed and leave me up with him. Mm-hmm. Always. Yeah. Always.
That's because I sugar them up and they gonna stay up. You know, I mean, I'm that grandpa where I don't say no. Yep, get as many as you want, whatever you want. You know, and it's just always open arm. But I tell you what, though, it's a feeling that until you have grandkids, it's hard to describe it. You know, because those kids, and I think it's more because having your own kids, it was a work ethic. You know, we worked and we, you know, it was all, you know, it's a process. Mm-hmm. But my grandkids is like, well, we don't work as much, and it's more, you give them more attention, you know, mm-hmm. and you, to me, you enjoy them more. You don't send them to bed like you do your own kids because you get tired of them because the long day from work and all the other stuff. And your grandkids, and it's like, you know, she'll stay up 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and when they decide to go to bed, she'll go to bed.
Yeah.
Not me. It's like, hey, I'll see y'all in the morning.
Oh, yeah. Are there any Pee Wee plans brewing yet?
Dude, it's crazy. It's because some days they won't ride all day. Mm-hmm. And the next day, they don't even want to touch the bike. Don't even want to come in the same room the bike is in. It is so crazy. It's like, you know, here I'm thinking, and it's like, all right, here we go again. And it's like, no, we don't, do we have to? Obviously, I'm not going to tell you have to, you know. Yeah. Yeah. And little James is like, Dad, I sent them out there for you to make them ride. I said, no, but that's what you did to me. I said, son, it is different times right now.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Mm-hmm. Hey, we're going to take one more break to hear from our sponsors. Back for one last segment with the Stewarts. Everybody, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors, here with James and Sonya Stewart. So, I think it was, what was the race that James came back to the first time and like helped announce? Was that like?
On the helping announcing, it was outdoor. He did.
No, it was a, I'm talking about the Supercross, but the first Supercross I saw him at. I was like walking through the tunnel and he's all, hey. I was like,
did he come to Supercross?
I think he did something with Tampa.
It was Tampa. It was Brock Pickle's first race back. But I was like, dang, dude, you got big. So is that like, racers have to train their whole lives, right? And watch what they eat and everything. It's like when they retire, they're just like, ah. But then, I saw him at Fox Raceway last year, and I was like, dude, you look good.
Yeah.
And he goes, I'm training for coming back.
Yeah.
Right? But I was joking with him about it, right? And I was like, how big did you get? And he goes, I might have seen a 2 on the scale, and I jumped off real quick before the digital stopped going like that. But you guys saw it firsthand. What was it? Was it just him just living life and enjoying stuff?
Yeah, I think it was. I really do. I really do think it was. But then, honestly, when he started doing that Bubba's World podcasting thing, mm-hmm. I think from watching, looking, seeing yourself on the film, mm-hmm. on the camera, like everybody else, you kind of get that like, ooh, yeah, that ain't
no,
good.
No, he thinned up before that, though, before the podcast.
He started thinning up before the podcast. Yeah. Yeah, but he still was pretty at a good weight, like, at the beginning. And then it just gradually just...
You know, yeah, the camera so. Camera does that some way.
Yeah,
I met some guy. I met a guy at San Diego this weekend, and he mm-hmm. goes, "Hey, man, I love your show." And he goes, "Man, you're lean. You look a lot fatter on your show." Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
So, with Malk being the current son that's racing so far, what has been the absolute highlight? Was it his title? Was it, you know? Like, I always think of the first heat race in Salt Lake because Anton got that photo of you in the stands in the background. I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I would say his championship year in the 250 class, it was one of them deal where Malcolm said that he was going to win the championship. Mm-hmm. In 2016, he said, "I'm putting all in. I'm giving everything. I'm giving it all. Mm-hmm. I ain't going out. I'm gonna ride my motorcycle. I'm gonna fish." And so he's like, "I said, okay, we'll see." He said, and he was like, "And if I do win the championship, I'm gonna buy me a brand new bass boat, and I don't have to use your old boat anymore." And I said, "Man, that's awesome. That is absolutely awesome." And you know, he come out. I'm not sure what place he got the first race. Done good. And then we went to Canada, mm-hmm. and got in that first turn pile up and ripped his jersey off, and he come by and the bike wasn't running right, so he make lap, pull in the pit, you know, and he pull in the pit first time and go back out, still wasn't right, come back in the pit second time, and it was like, oh boy, he's gonna pull off the track, this gonna kill his championship deal. He didn't. Mm-hmm. He was determined that he was gonna do it, and he rode that bike out, and I told him, I say, "Mount, you know, with that ride right there, you will win the championship because it's in your mind. It's no doubt whatsoever because you motivated, you dedicated to it, mm-hmm. you'll win the championship." And it paying out, he did win the championship. We go back last week race. I don't know if you ever rode with a bike with no front fender. It is difficult enough to ride with no number plate.
Yeah.
But obviously with no front fender, you don't know where the front wheel is. And for him to finish, to go out and finish the race with no front fender, I don't see one of our top tier guy doing it. I just don't see, you know, Malcolm has a big heart. He really has a big heart when it comes to racing. And that's what kept Malcolm and got him to where he's at now. Cause little James always had a big heart, you know, mm-hmm. it's like never give up. Don't give it up. Don't give up because just never know what happened.
Yeah. So last year, a lot of the guys on the Huskies and the KTMs with the new chassis, they struggle a little bit, and they seem to all have it dialed in this year. It's Malcolm's second year with Alden, second year on the bike. He looks to me a lot more comfortable, a lot more confident. The results haven't shown it yet, obviously, mm-hmm. but I firmly believe his first 450 win's coming this year. I mean, I'm sure you guys feel the same way.
I feel the same way, and you know, and it's one of those deals. It's when you know you fit, when you racing against competition like we do have, when you know you fit, I think you kind of forget about a lot of other things because you're not worried about fatiguing. And I think, you know, things happen. But that fitness is your confidence. Mm-hmm. If you know you fit, you're going to overcome all the rest of the stuff because you know you have the fit. It's when you in doubt, you know, and that's what's, you know, happened with Malcolm. And I felt last year he was fit way, he was in way better shape than he ever been in his life. Mm-hmm. And I think it took him to this year to realize that it's like, man, I can go the distance. But when you don't really, you haven't been the distance, you know, at that level, you second guess yourself. This mm-hmm. year, he's not second guessing himself. This year, he's letting it rip.
Yeah. Yeah, I can remember times a few years ago, riding mountain bikes with him and going, man, come on. You let this old man beat you?
Yeah, yeah.
But what's it like, Mom, watching your boys race at this level? I mean, is it nerve-wracking? Are you used to it?
Both. It is nerve-wracking. I am used to it, but it's a little bit more nerve-wracking with Malcolm. I don't know, Big James always say, because that's my baby. Mm. Yeah, but
that's a baby.
It's not like that. But it's nerve-wracking though, because I always been that mom that even with little James, no matter how good he was, until you come across that checker flag, he can be 2 seconds out front, 5 seconds out front, it doesn't matter. I've seen it, been there, done that. You know, he can wreck at the end. With Malcolm is pretty much about the overall when the gate drops. Like I'm nervous, but if you sit there and watch me, you'll never know it. Like my face especially just stays the same mm-hmm. with him. Like I don't want to be bothered. I have blinders on. But people still try to talk to me while he's racing. I'm like, dude, I just want everybody to be quiet right now. You know what I'm saying? I'm just, I should do like he does. Just put earplugs in his ear. Yeah. He don't. But it is nerve-wracking too.
What would you say each of you, what are your roles at the races with Mal? Like, what do you talk with him about? What are you talking about?
I don't talk about it, but honestly, my role is exactly what it is, mama. That's it. I stay in my lane and, you know, he wants something to eat. I make him something to eat. We barely discuss riding or racing or mm-hmm. stuff like that. I usually don't talk to Malcolm unless he tell me to come up in the rig and, you know, talk a little bit. And he may say, well, what do you think or whatever? But that's it. That is it. That's mm-hmm. my role is just mom. Him, that's a whole nother level. A whole nother level. Yeah, he everything.
Well, I keep him in check, you know. I let him know when he's laboring. I let him know when he's doing good. And I let him know when he can do better. You know, and that's, I'm gonna always be dad. And I have done it from the beginning. And, you know, and I don't know any other way. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just, you know, some people say, oh, he's hard on him. But I know what it takes. I've been there. Mm-hmm. I know exactly what it takes. And the minute you let your guard down, you've been hit in the face. And I don't like to get hit in the face, so I'm always got my guards up, and I'm always pursuing him, you know, and want the best out of Malcolm. So sometimes it takes a little digging to get it out of him, but, you know, I try to piss him off. If I can piss him off, I know he's going to ride good.
Yeah.
You know, because he's too happy.
Yeah, he is a happy guy.
You know, I mean, how do you go fight a guy when he's smiling?
Yeah,
you know, I mean, he's like, well, do I hit him or do I hug him? You know.
Yeah. Well, guys, thank you so much for spending some time with us here today for the SML show, mm-hmm. and look forward to seeing you at the races the rest of the year.
Yep.
And
I do have one question though.
Okay.
You know, you've been around this industry a long, long time doing what you do, and, you know, and do you feel Malcolm falls more than the average rider that he's racing against?
No.
You don't?
Well, I mean, he fell too much on Sunday or Saturday, but I don't think he's necessarily a crasher.
I would say the same thing, because I get people, it doesn't matter. Which is good because they watching him. And that's what I tell Malcolm. I said, if they talking about you, they watching you. You know, oh, he falls and he's always crashing. He's always this and that. if you even like Little James crashed, but he crashed trying to win. Mm-hmm. And Tomite crashed trying to win. Mm-hmm. I think all those top guys crash because they want to win.
Yeah.
Then no one go out there and ride a motorcycle and say, oh, I'm going to crash. You know, and it's sickening when you get people say, oh, he crashes all the time. He's this and he's that. And it's like, well, have a good rider crash.
Yeah. Because my dad told me, if you're not crashing once in a while, you're not trying.
Absolutely. Yeah. Your dad was right. And that's what I pursue with Malcolm. It's like, find that edge, find that limit, and bike it down one.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. But some things, honestly, you look at a lot of stuff, you really can't predict. That's what I look at. I mean, some things just, you know, you all of a sudden, you know, you're riding and it's like, boom, it's gone. There's no, you know, there's no control. If you run into somebody and crash, I mean, that's all, yeah, on another level because you, mm-hmm. but, I mean, honestly, I don't see even all the crashes. I mean, what do you think, like, you know, he could have avoided? I don't.
Well, if they,
I don't.
Same thing I told him on that first crash Saturday night, I said, you lost focus.
I don't think the rut took him. The rut shot him over on the hay bale.
We don't have to argue on camera, but that's my point.
The rut shot him in the hay bale. If you watched it, somebody has a video of it. Yeah. He hit that, the rut shot him into the hay bale.
Yeah.
Like, that rut did. And I mean, you ain't trying to take that rut and say, hey, you know what? I want to crash right here. Let me go in this rut. It's going to shoot me, you know, mm-hmm. and stuff.
That's where we have all our differences. Because mama hen is that
I'm not mama hen. I'm trying to look at the whole picture. Nobody, trust me, Malcolm do not want to crash at all.
No.
But when you racing at that level and you're going that fast, there's lines out there you're trying to take. You don't know what those lines, when you come around the second time, that ain't the same line. It never is. You don't know, you know. It was fine when I went through it, when I came around a lot. That's one lap. Now it's a whole totally different story, is it? You know. But, and he should know more than anybody. I mean, how many times you done raced and you done crashed out?
That's why I retired, though.
I get that. But, he's got to, no matter what.
Yeah, see, Malcolm, though, he crashes, in my mind, like everyone else crashes. James would crash huge because he was trying so hard, right? Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, he was going to lose. That's just
like, I don't
motto.
See that on Malcolm. Malcolm
no. No, he's going. He's going. But like I say, that's big James.
Yeah, I think, you know, I know we're running off the show, but we just check. I think the biggest thing with Little James, and I say it from the beginning of his pro career, Little James was better than his motorcycle.
Yeah.
And he went his career, you know, better than his motorcycle, and he was trying to make up the difference with his motorcycle. Today's time, these guys got, you know, they got the team that's working so hard, and the technology have changed so rapidly that they're up there with the rider. But we don't have that. We have great talent rider, but I just don't think we have the riders, and that's including Malcolm, that would be able to hold a stick to James and Ricky McGrath back in their prime. You know, racing what they race with.
Yeah.
You know, and it's different. You know, everybody's saying, oh, you know, they want to do comparison, but you can't really comparison because technology has changed. They have so much, you know, great, you know, from gas and, you know, and fork oil, all these different, you know, that they have made better wasn't back then in those days. So that's why I always give credit to Ricky, you know, McGrath and Little James. Those are the dinosaur days. And we can even go back to Bradshaw and, you know, LaRocco and all those. It was a different time, but I just know when Ricky and McGrath was racing, they was racing.
Yeah.
That's what racing, they was racing. That was bar to bar, but they race each other clean. We don't have that this day.
Yeah.
We have this dirty riding and, you know, and no one, you know, Adam Cincerello come up to Malcolm and say, thanks for racing me clean in that heat race. Mm-hmm. We don't see that anymore.
Especially not the Salt Lake finale.
No. It's like, that's what you want. That's what the fans are paying their money to come and, you know, see guys race bar to bar without taking each other out. Mm-hmm. That's racing. You know, that's what you're giving the people their money by. Every rider can go out there and T-bone a rider. If everybody that lined up, those 22 riders on the gate had in their mind, and they get somebody they're going to T-bone, what are we going to do with our sport?
Yeah. Be 10 guys on the line next week.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have to look at that, you know, and instead of just, you know, ooh and all and, you know, great, you know, promoting a guy, taking another guy out because you're hurting his sport.
Yeah. You know, I told Malcolm, like, at Salt Lake last year when he got taken out, I was like, dude, or even the Marvin thing,
yeah.
I was like, man, I would never want you that mad at me, but like, how do you control yourself, you know? Like, he never retaliates.
Because he was looking at the bigger picture.
Yeah.
He was looking at the bigger picture, but then you go back and they're, you know, still, they, to this day, they still talk about Malcolm Anderson, and Malcolm's taking Anderson out, and, you know, blase, blase. And it was like, it got to the point where it was like, how much do you want to be bullied? You know, this guy ain't going to stop.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to keep taking, and I'm not going to back down. That's it. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to learn my lesson now so we can move forward. And that's what happened.
Yeah.
And Daytona was like, hey, that's it, dude. And I asked Anderson come over and say, hey, man, let's just squash this.
Yeah.
He did. He come over after Daytona. He really, see, Malcolm is different now. He's little James looked at it at the big picture. Malcolm, when he first started, you took him out. He forget about racing. His whole idea was to get you back instantly. Not next week, this week. Mm-hmm. You know, and it changed on him, you know, so he got matured and started looking at the big picture. Mm-hmm. But when Anderson is so bizarre, we should have won Daytona last year. We was the fastest guy there, same way he won his heat race, but he was naturally fast. He wasn't like he was riding over his head. Mm-hmm. So right before the main event, Roger Costa come over to me. He said, listen, Big James, tell Malcolm not to get in the Anderson deal.
Yeah.
He's fast enough to win this thing. Make sure you tell him. Malcolm getting ready to go out. I said, Mal, listen to me. No matter what Anderson do to you, son, just block it out. Go win this race. I'm up in the stands, and I see Anderson come in, jam Toe Mike. Toe Mike jams into Malcolm. I was like, before anything, he's off the side of the track. I was like, no. I said, no, because yeah. I knew exactly what Malcolm was going to do. No. Well, before it ever happened.
Yeah.
I was like, no. Because I can see it in his eyes. Mm-hmm. He said, I had enough is enough. And that's what he told me. Dad, I am sorry, but I couldn't. I had enough. The guy's been beating on me. I had to put a stop to it.
Yeah. All right.
Anyway, fat burger time, huh?
Yeah, time for fat burger. Guys, thanks for checking out the SML show, and we'll see you next week.